Welcome to Bending the Lines, building videos that drive immediate results and long-term loyalty. Everyone will remember that title at the end of the day. This session is sponsored by Video Aptitude, me. We are a video strategy and production company for e-commerce sites that truly specialize in creating the unique content that everyone wants to manage, distribute, share, and do everything else with. So we're running out of time, so I'm not gonna plug myself anymore. We have a wonderful panel. Tom Santé, he's a video production specialist for All Online Shoes. Robert Moses, videographer for Eastern Mountain Sports. Robert Reed, video producer, blinds.com. And me, I'm Kevin Edwards. I don't know if I said that yet. So. Let's just get underway and get going. I believe the title can really be broken down into three core components: content, production, and community, followed by an essential evolution. Because what you say in your product videos through content and how you say it through production is really the most powerful connections that you have with your customers online. Whether you have a B&M location to make another impression, your online videos really should be the gold standard. They create the voice, personify the brand, creating a window into who you are. So when it comes to product video content, what do your customers want to know about your products? And what do they need to know? What will your products actually look like in their lives? And what impact will I have? And equally important, what questions can you address before they're asked? What type of form, are you bringing into their lives? What functions can you use your products for other than maybe the obvious? Could your customers really be quick to say, dude, I just bought an awesome product? Where are your products best used? What specific features should they be aware of? And convenience is always important. Your content should be relevant, applicable, helpful. Because, I mean, if there's a big blue elephant in the room, probably addressing your product video. We did not do it in this one. But once you begin addressing these, once you shoot, there will be an immediate impact. Good video programs don't begin in the product videos. How-tos are a great way to connect with your customers by providing knowledge they didn't previously have. Don't be afraid to think beyond how to install a specific product. Unpacking or care instructions are important. Preparedness, exercises, directly with the community beyond are fantastic. Informative performance techniques on how to get the most out of your products are a great way to connect with your customers. Maybe opening up into a little bit of who you are as a company. Don't be afraid to have to take your shirt off, I guess. Share that with the entire world. Also, look into production. Production is really important. It adds an additional layer into telling your story. It really helps drive emotion and strengthen the connection to the customer with your brand. Overlays, Aiden. You'll see overlay kind of bouncing around. The close-ups, backgrounds, the flag, boat shoes. Getting outside of the studio is extremely important. And adding an additional layer and telling the story of who you are and what you're doing. This is the 10-year sweatshirt. The last 10 years. I think you should let your production evolve. Dollar Shave Club video, would not experience the success it had. The founder Mike simply stayed seated at his desk, adding some transition movement coupled with some crazy ideas made the difference and brought this tiny little company with a simple idea really into a global spotlight. And I think it's important to make changes and see how the videos perform, because there's amazing tools to track videos, performance, and feedback. So I think properly aligning content with production in a dynamic process builds your community and creates long-term longevity. And the three panelists that we have here today, they've actually done this, and they've done a very good job at it. So on that note, I'd like to welcome Tom Santé.
Thank you. Thank you, Kevin.
You're welcome, Tom.
That's a great video.
Thanks.
Okay. Hey, guys. How's everyone? Welcome. I want to thank LiveClicker for having me. I want to thank you guys for being here. Susie Ryder was awesome. Great way to start it. And the Dove Sketch commercials I thought were great. Kind of moved me a little bit. And I was really surprised. 4%? That's it? I think you're all beautiful. I just wanted to say that. Okay. So my presentation, I called it Finding the Right Fit, because, you know, ultimately the videos, they do, you know, they're here to help. We want our customers to be engaged, and we want the videos to help drive sales and stuff. And we did a lot of experimenting and testing, and we think we kind of found the right fit for us. So my goal in this presentation is to inspire you guys and your companies to sort of find the right fit for your companies with the video. Okay, so a little backstory about us. We were founded in 1996. We were the first online shoe retailer. We carry about 300 brands. And in 2008, mid-2008, is when we started doing video production, adding videos to the site. And currently, we have about 4,000 pieces of content throughout the site, YouTube, et cetera. And the number one kind of function of our video program is the product video. And what I have kind of here is just an example of our product detail page. You can see the shoe, thumbnail, and then kind of on the top right corner of the boot, there's a little play icon. And when you would click that, it would take you to a lovely short video, which even that was tested. You know, in the beginning, we had the player sort of under the thumbnail imagery, and it did not do as well as when we sort of moved it to that position. So that's kind of the kit and caboodle. But we also do video on things like Facebook, and we have a blog that has videos. And on our box, this image down here on the bottom, we put a QR code. And when you scan that QR code, there's a nice thank you message, employees sort of, you know, thanking you for the purchase. And we feel like that kind of, it all adds to the loyalty and getting the customer to really sort of identify with our brand. And then we, you know, over the years since I've been there, we've kind of experimented with lots of different kinds of videos. Starting on the top, we're doing 360s on products. We do kind of like email campaign messaging. We do tips like teaching people through experts, what to, like showing them through the video. And then we also have videos that, experts can talk about the shoes specifically. So we do a lot of a variety of stuff. So then we kind of sort of like are constantly asking ourselves, what do the customers want, and then how we can create it. And that's something I think everybody should do, is just always be asking yourself, what can you do that they're going to love? And this is a video.
This is John with Brooks. Here I have the Cascadia 7, and it is one of the most versatile trail shoes on the market. And it's a very pure technical trail shoe from Brooks. Starting off with our pivot technology and the heel and the forefoot, on both sides, it gives you 4 points of contact acts like the suspension on an off-road vehicle and keeps your foot in a neutral plane on uneven terrain. In the forefoot, we have our ballistic rock shield, which protects your foot from sharp objects. And in the upper, we have our anatomical last, which is really going to fit to the shape of your foot real naturally and keep your foot from moving around inside the shoe. So the Cascadia 7, a very versatile trail shoe that looks amazing on the foot and comes in great colors. You're going to absolutely love it.
So that's an example of what we kind of used to do. So we created a lot of videos like that. And there's some factors to that. Finding someone to speak about it who is passionate about the product. The time it takes to edit the footage down. Where to film it, et cetera, et cetera. And we're always trying to figure out like how we can create more content. So we made a lot of these videos and they worked and they were good, but we started, through LiveClicker's feedback tool, we started getting comments like, please show the boot on an actual foot. How does it look on an actual foot? And then we had someone else say, I can read the description, but I cannot see how it looks on the foot. Please let us see someone walking in the shoe. We got a lot of comments like that. So we listened and we kind of thought, well, that's what they want to see, so let's give it a try. So here's the exact same shoe, but just kind of in a different way. No audio, no music, just real simple. Now, if you were a shopper, just by a show of hands, like the guy talking about it, who liked that one more than just seeing it on someone's foot? Couple? Okay. What about seeing it on the foot? Who found that one more beneficial? Cool. Okay, that's very interesting. Because, again, comments. So we started putting more, I'll get back to that. So we started reading these comments. The boot is viewed in action. You can see how it moves on the feet. You get to see the shoe worn and get a better idea of how it will look on you. Really love it. Do it for all your shoes. This is very helpful to see how the shoe fits and moves when you walk and wear it. Thank you very much for providing this type of video. So immediately we kind of started getting a lot more comments like this. Now here's the fascinating thing. This is kind of the whole boom of it. Using the analytical tools, we checked both videos, and although the one where the model is wearing it isn't on as much, check out the bottom. First, plays and impressions, 73.9%, 88.5%. Video length, about half as long, but everything kind of lines up about the same. Full view, 46%, full view, 45%. It's basically like the results were the same, but the video on the right took a fraction of the time to make and so much easier to put together. The editing time, you can imagine you're filming with somebody and you've got take after take and you're mashing it together and you're trying your best to make it work. But on the right, it was just super quick. So we could basically get a lot more content in the same amount of time. So we tested that pretty thoroughly, and it was kind of consistent. Excuse me? I would say that the revenue, that's great. They're kind of about the same. The dates that they were on the site were less, but if you kind of sort of match everything up, they would be about the same too. So this was kind of a seen through a lot of this stuff. We did this on a lot. I just use this as an example. So we started shooting everything like this, and our customers really seemed to identify with this the best. We kind of found like the right model. They want 20, 30 seconds, someone in the shoe, the appropriate clothing. So we kind of found what I think is the right way to connect with our customer. might not be the same for everybody. Not everybody is going to want to see the shoe on foot. Some people preferred the talking about it, but it made sense for us because we, you know, it's one person. We're trying to do a lot of things, but this just made the most sense for us. So why did this work for us? Shorter filming time and editing time. Easy access to the products. We have a ginormous warehouse where all of our products are located, and logistically it just made sense to go there and just film as much as we could, and that seemed to be good. More content, the better. You know, showing the product in motion. You have this great gift. You have video. It can move. You can, and it isn't just like a static image. So we kind of took more advantage of seeing a shoe in its natural state. It provides useful information. They can see plenty of pictures and read a description, but in the end, you're putting it on your foot. So let's see what it looks like on your foot. And I feel like it completes our site experience. I think it looks just beautiful when you can see the imagery and read the description, and then there's just like a nice little video to show how it would look in action. And again, best bang for the buck. If we could film one video of a guy talking about it as opposed to five of the, you know, a model wearing the shoe, we've decided to kind of go with the five because it just makes sense for us. So test. We test a lot. I'm kind of in love with testing things. And I recommend that everyone sort of just test different things, like find out what's going to kind of make your customers happy. And find a happy balance between art and commerce. It was kind of like what Susie was saying. You know, don't make commercials, make content. I feel like showing the shoe on a foot isn't so much a commercial as it is a glimpse into, you know, like, it's not as much a pitch. I'm not trying to pitch you something. I'm just showing you. I'm just giving you content. Think outside the shoe box, which is always cool. And, you know, you will find the right formula for success. But I feel that for us, it took a little bit of time, but we did find the right combination. Live Clicker certainly helped us with the tools, the analytics, the comments, the widget reports. It all helped. And that's it. That's my presentation. So thank you very much. Yes. Yes, on our product page, it's basically all, you know, written out, and there's descriptions and reviews, and it's like we were kind of just giving you the same information, but just through video. So yes, we could sort of add more, if we wanted to, but they have access to all the information they need. They just never got to see it on a foot. Yes, absolutely. Which isn't bad, but we're trying to figure out what more can we give them, and showing it on the foot seemed to just be the perfect thing for us.
When you say test, you test live?
Well, we have a couple people at our company that do just nothing but test. They're just test wizards. But we do a lot of tests too, I do at least, like within Live Clicker. So like those widget reports, we can look at those and say, well, yeah, wow, they're like pretty much matched. And we would not have kind of gotten that information if it wasn't for, like, the comments too. Like some videos we put up and they just didn't get good results. The comments were bad, so we would take them down or something.
We're going to move on and, sure, and get Robert going here, and then we'll definitely have some time for Q&A at the end, and that can run over. I just want to make sure that we're not stepping on toes of anyone else here. So, Robert.
Thanks. Is this, hello? Hi, how are you? I'm Robert Moses. I want to thank LiveClicker for asking me to come here. They're a great company, you do great stuff. I work for Eastern Mountain Sports. So for those of you that don't know Eastern Mountain Sports, it's like a small REI, and we're on the east coast of this country, where I just came from yesterday. So when I heard YouTube this morning, I thought, that was great. That was everything I wanted to tell you. And you know, YouTube is huge, and we're small, and REI is big. And then when I heard the presentation, I thought, man, we're doing everything right. So, except small. So I wanted to try to get across to you how we come about making our videos, why we make them like we do. First of all, what is our company? What you want to do when you make videos is you want to tell a story. You have to have a story to tell, even if it's just about shoes or whatever it is. This is the prime, most important thing. And you have to know who you're telling your story to and how to tell it to them. And that's all you need to do. So we know who our customer is. Our customer is, on the previous slide, I'll just tell it to you, is the outdoor athlete and enthusiast from novice to expert. So anybody who wants to get outdoors, any age, any lifestyle, you don't have to be a crazy like GoPro through the air flying type person, just a regular family with kids or anyone who wants to get out there. And through our videos, we try to tell that story. So we're trying to make a heartfelt connection between, you know, us and our customers. The big thing is that we are our customers. All the people that work at Eastern Mountain Sports, we like to get out there. We're outdoor enthusiasts. So we are talking to ourselves through these videos to ourselves and getting ourselves inspired. What we're trying to do also is sell gear. That's an important part. But to sell that gear, we want people to connect viscerally to what we're doing. And my job is simply, actually, I just create the videos, so I'm not a numbers person, so don't ask me about numbers, okay? So here's a small video we made. How do I set this thing? Oops. Play. Oh, there it is.
Eastern Mountain Sports makes it easy to get on the water.
So, we're selling all that stuff in that video, but we didn't tell you. And what you just wanted through the video was to have people connect. Our basic aim was to let people know how easy it is to go out and buy a kayak, buy an SUP, board and get out there and do what those people are doing. None of those people were paid talent. Those are all people that work in our, what we call our base camp, our headquarter office. So the big thing with video is the medium for this age. It's the way to tell a story. So just like a rock painting, as Susie mentioned, it's like an Egyptian hieroglyph with branding things. It's the newspaper, it's the town crier, it's the TV ad, now it's the internet, now it's anybody with a camera or anything anywhere who has a story to tell. Each and every one of those videos that's great is telling a story. We have a mission statement to deliver superior customer service through knowledgeable, credible, and authentic expertise. So that's our big thing. Anyone from REI here? Okay. So when you come into one of our stores, a store associate is happy to talk to you for hours on end about some piece of gear, backpack, or whatever it is. We try to give people as much content and knowledge as possible, and we use all of that stuff so we are able to give them that content. We train our store associates. We have big gatherings where they come and they learn about the gear, the backpacks, the sleeping bags, the tents, and everything like that. In our stores, we have information tags on the products. There's all kinds of things. On our website, we have pages and pages of content where you can read about the gear. And we take full advantage of our store. We have store guides, climbing guides. We have schools. These are like climbing schools and kayaking schools. So we use all of these in creating our videos. So how did you like the GoPro videos? They were really cool, right? So strangely enough, you never know what people are going to really like. So this is a large number for us, okay? Remember, we're not GoPro REI. And the video that I'm going to show you, really it's a boring video. And this is our highest, this has gotten the most number of people to watch. And they got it to it through YouTube by simply typing in, how do I fit a backpack? You're going to have to.
Yep. No problem.
I'm confused.
Glad you worked with the camera.
Hi, I'm Dave from Eastern Mountain Sports, and this is Abby, and today we're going to be talking about pack fitting. So the fit of the pack is extremely important because that's what's going to keep you comfortable out on the trail. If you're out on the trail and you're uncomfortable, you're not going to have a good experience. Today we're going to fit Abby to the Eastern Mountain Sports Long Trail Pack. Even though we're looking at the EMS Long Trail Pack today, the tips that we're going to be giving you can be used for any full-size backpack. And we already have it stuffed with some weight, so that it's gonna mimic what it's gonna feel like out on the trail. When we initially set up the pack, we wanna make sure all the straps are loose, and we will adjust them once we get them on. So now that Abby has the pack on, I'm gonna have her tighten up the waist belt on her iliac crest where she needs it, and then we're gonna snug down the shoulder straps to get them snug. Connect that sternum strap, and again, make sure that all your straps are nice and snug. Everything is properly fit. The fit we're looking for at the waist belt is just making sure that the top edge of the waist belt is about 1 inch above the iliac crest. To find your iliac crest, which is basically the top of your hip bone, we're just gonna take our thumb, or I'm gonna have Abby take her thumbs, and just look for those bones right at her side. So the top of that bone is just below the top of the waist belt. The other part of the fit that we're looking for is the contour of the shoulder strap. We want to make sure that strap contours to the shoulder and doesn't have any space towards the back of the shoulder pack. And as we turn forward, we can see that her sternum strap is nice and tight to keep the shoulder straps from falling out to the outer part of the shoulder. We don't want it too tight because we don't want those shoulder straps to come in and pinch on the neck, but we don't want them too loose so they come off the side of the shoulder. If we do have some space between the shoulder strap and Abby's shoulder here, we can make that adjustment with the torso length adjustment built into the pack. That would probably mean that the pack is too long and we need to decrease the distance from the shoulder strap to the hip belt. On the other hand, if we notice that the waist belt is coming up high on Abby's hips, the distance from the waist belt to the shoulder strap may actually be too short, and we would have to lengthen the adjustment. We also want to check and make sure that the load strap coming off of Abby's shoulder is at about 45 degrees.
What this load strap does is it actually pulls the pack close to your back and controls all the weight in the pack. If it's too loose, the pack will sit back too far. If it's too tight, in some instances, it'll actually lift the shoulder strap right up off your shoulder. So there's a happy medium there, but again, 45 degrees off the shoulder is perfect. Okay, Abby, while you're out on the trail, you're carrying a lot of weight. So you'll probably have to lean forward a little bit to control this weight. And when you lean forward, do you notice where the weight is hitting you?
Yeah, right on my hips.
Perfect. That's just what we're looking for. About 65% of the weight of the pack should be sitting in your hips with a little bit on your shoulders. As you're walking out through the trail, your legs are going to be able to support that weight a lot better than just having it hang right off your shoulders.
So we knew who our customer is. That's somebody who really wants to know everything about backpacks. Wants to put on a backpack and wants to go backpacking for a long time and be comfortable in it. That's a really boring, that's not a GoPro type of video. But that video, more than half the people who clicked on that video who found it just through searching YouTube, how do I fit a backpack, watched the whole thing through, 3.5 minutes of, hey Abby, do that. They also just, he's a store associate, the guy, he's a store manager. Abby's a content, she manages content, she types in information. They came down into the studio and we shot that in not a long time. But the thing is, it's information rich for the people that you want to get it to. The other thing we do is that our videos are one piece of a coordinated campaign. So they complement all the other content that we put out through social mediums, online, and our school websites. So this is pretty important for us. Again, we provide all the content in these videos. And we also create a whole number of very quick product videos, which are shorter. You went onto our website and clicked on a product and got to the product page, you'd be able to look at a little video like this. So in that type of video, we just try to very quickly highlight the highlights of a particular product. And we have a whole bunch of those for particular products. To support our brand, we create videos that promote outdoor sports, adequately communicate the outdoor culture. We create instructional articles that help the customer to keep informed in making their buying decisions, as well as helping them get the most from the product. So here we came up with this idea, is we sell tents, and somebody buys a tent and they go out there into the outdoors, and then they don't know how to put up the tent. All of a sudden, they're on the top of a mountain. So inside, on the label of the tent, we put a little QR code, and with your smartphone, you can snap the QR code, and if you've got reception out there, you can get a video of how to set up that tent. These are all information-rich videos aimed specifically at people that want that information. Six different sizes. We made a video exactly like this for each one of them. They're on the layer on the tag, and anyone can pick that tag and watch how to put it up. It's also online on the web page for the pin as well as a video information. And you know, basically, this is shot. Took us about an hour or less to shoot it, about half an hour to edit it. Then we got a template and shoot the rest and edit them and put it up. And you know, you don't try to make it too jazzy and too creamy. Just try to keep it simple, clear, and concise and pleasant. So we also got some, you know, we also have a bunch of GoPro type videos. I don't want to bore you with those because they're not as crazy as those. But we make those with our school. So we use, you know, all our resources, our associates, our store associates, our schools, our blog, Facebook, Twitter, and everything like that, and direct mail and email campaigns. It's all a coordinated thing. Like first video you saw, the Easy Kayak, when we did that, that was coordinated with a whole bunch of other media input as well at the same time. And we have to say that this whole thing is enabled by LiveClicker, who put together some figures for me. And you can see how from last year to this year, how we've jumped up a real lot. There is a question on the conversion rate in 2012, 1.3, we dispute that. We think it's a little bit higher than that. However, not much bad. Now it's 5.9 conversion rate, which is really good. And these are made with you know, pretty simple, easy to make, easy to craft videos. You showed me a 5-minute time. If there are any quick questions, I'd be happy to.
We can grab a Q&A in the end here.
Okay.
And but we can keep rolling.
So thanks, folks.
I think we'll have some good Q&A in the end, so if we just keep rolling and save as much time as possible.
All right.
Don't need me to introduce you.
Okay. Well, my name is Robert Reed. I'm with Blinds.com, and I'm really excited to be with you guys today. I'm going to try to keep things a little bit brief because obviously we're a little short on time. So probably the first thing you're thinking about is, what is a window covering company doing talking about engaging video? I mean, blinds go up, and blinds go down. So, I mean, seriously? But really, I'm here a little bit more to talk about culture and how we use our culture of our company to really incorporate that into our videos. And I think that does come across pretty well. So if you look at the slide here and look a little closely, you'll notice that you see a lot of energetic, passionate people that have a lot of great ideas. And we really encourage that in our company. Within our marketing group, we really reach out to the other employees in the company to really help us drive content and to determine, you know, what our customers really are needing. So they're a great source of inspiration for us. And it's a big part of, I think, our success. So let me just page down here. Okay. Our main goal at Blinds.com is to actually make the process of buying a very difficult product surprisingly easy and exciting. And if you think about it, when you're buying a custom product, there can literally be millions of combinations of things to put together to make a product. So in addition to the normal questions you get, we get questions like, how am I going to measure this? How am I going to install this? What color is right for me? How's it going to look in my window? There's all kind of questions our customers have. And in addition to that, you're talking about a product that they're not even familiar with. It's something that's probably brand new to them. So one of our goals really is to prevent you from having to deal with these people. These kind of people that you run into when you go to your local hardware store, people that are real judgmental, that are real opinionated about what you should have, even though they have no idea really what you need. This is really not the best experience for a lot of people. And one of our goals is through the use of video is to allow you to avoid this situation. So let's talk a little bit about our video program. We actually started very, very small.
In 2006, if you notice on the picture on your left there, that's actually us working on our first videos, which in our case, we actually worked on how to measure and how to install, because we know these are the kind of things that our customers were really needing the most help with. So you can actually see our full production studio. It's about 4 feet by 4 feet and two pieces of plywood and a little green screen behind that. And it's kind of stuffed between a couple of cubicles. But that was actually enough space for us to get the ball rolling. And we used that to our advantage to start putting out videos that really, I think, made a big difference to our customers. We got a lot of feedback through our call center and just through letters to really help us understand that we were hitting the target with that. And so going forward, we've actually made, obviously, a number of videos since then, but we started with the ones we thought were the most important. Now we're at the point where, as you can see here on the right-hand side, we're actually building out a full production studio, which is going to allow us to do a lot more work than we were able to do when we started. But it was just a matter of, over time, kind of refining what we're doing, learning what the customers are telling us, learning from that, and then just kind of moving forward with the types of videos we're producing. So where we're at today is we have about 250 videos on our site. We actually use our talent in-house for pretty much everything we do. As I mentioned, we have a lot of passionate employees. Well, basically, these are experts in what they do. So they're perfect people for us to work with to help create content, to actually display the content. Because of their expertise, they can actually talk about the product very authoritatively. And not just even for product demonstrations, but sometimes even how to fix a product that may be broken or give you advice on things like that. So we really use our in-house talent a lot. We also crowdsource some of our videos, meaning that in many cases what we do is we work with our bloggers. That actually is a great source of content. We can actually get a number of things developed for us outside of our internal productions. So through working with outside people like that, that actually allows us to actually carry more content for our customers. And we also work with our PR group in our marketing department, because some of our content that we create really isn't just for the website. It's really sometimes for more social purposes. You know, we're not just necessarily looking at immediate sales-driven video. Sometimes it's really just more long-form video that's something that kind of keeps conversation going. So it's really important to know your statistics and your metrics. We actually, about a year and a half ago, we started working with LiveClicker on our site to help determine how our videos were doing. And it's really brought a lot of insight into what's successful and not what's not successful, because it's important to know both of those things. But when you know the information and you realize how many people are viewing videos and whether they're engaged or not, it actually helps you build a business case for whether or not you should be able to build the program even further. So in our case, just quick numbers, we know that in the second quarter of this year, we had an average of 90,000 views a month on our videos. But not just that, we also know that the engagement metrics associated with that. So we happen to know in our case, 80% of the people that watched a video at least watched it for 10 seconds. And then we know 70% of our viewers actually watched our videos for at least half the duration of the video. And 38% of them actually watched it for the full video, which for us is really great, because that's telling us that people are staying engaged in the content and they're getting something from that. And also we're getting feedback through customer comments and ratings. So that actually tells us a lot about how we're performing in the customer's eyes. But when we do get those comments, we like to look really more at the negative comments, because we want to find out what it is that they're not getting that they might be looking for. So there's a lot of things we can actually tweak on our videos based on the comments we're getting from our customers. Sometimes they're just simply confused because of the way we titled something. So we might just change the title and it clears that up and makes a much better experience. And then finally, of course, you really want to know what your financial return is on your video program. I happen to know, for example, last quarter we did 9,687 videos that were viewed that turned into purchases, which actually ended up over $3.4 million in revenue. So it's a lot easier for me to talk about building a new studio when I know that our videos are driving revenues. And in fact, I know that every video that's viewed on our site brings back $13 in revenue. And so these are the kind of numbers that really are great to know. And so if you have a good platform, you can really pick up on that. A few different types of videos we create. One of the main videos, of course, since not everybody is a window covering expert, is the product video. It allows us to kind of demonstrate features of a product that we're trying to point out. The video is much more powerful in demonstrating. But we also carry a variety of sales videos. I'm sorry, not sales videos, but service videos. Videos that relate to our services we provide. For example, we have a thing called SureFit, which is allowing our customers to feel confident that if they mismeasure, they can actually get that product replaced at no charge. And so we explain a little bit about that service. We also have an app that we like for our customers to take advantage of. So we demonstrate that type of service. We actually have another service we call face-to-face. And this face-to-face service is actually relatively new. It's been about a year since we've started that program. It's like an online video consultation with our customers. But initially, that program kind of got off to a rocky start because a lot of customers really didn't know what that was. They kind of thought someone was going to show up at their house, maybe. Or, you know, they didn't really know what it was. And so our group of folks in our face-to-face group got with us in marketing. We talked about it. And we figured if we did a video that would really help better define what this program is. It's since become our most watched video and has really helped face-to-face take off. So I figured I'd just show you this video and give you a better sense of what we're talking about. I don't know, it's not working. So you can always go to the site and learn more about face-to-face. Another type of video that we produce and really benefit, or I think our customers benefit from, is our DIY or empowerment video. Again, going back to where we first started, really our customer's point of pain was really feeling comfortable buying a product that they've never really interacted with before. So a big part of that is to show them how to measure a window. They can really see in under 2 minutes that they can do this, and it's really not a big deal. Sometimes trying to read that is much more difficult. When you see it and you realize in 2 minutes you can do this, it makes a big difference. So the measuring and the installation videos are a real big part of what we do. It really helps, you know, make a connection with the customer that they can do this. It gives them inspiration and confidence. But over and above that, we also produce a series of DIY videos. So whether or not you're a customer of ours or you've already bought a product, we still want you to be able to benefit from us in some way through video. And so this type of video would be like how to shorten a blind or how to reprogram your remote control for your motorized shade if it stops working. So these are kind of videos that our customers, I think, really benefit from because they really see that we're not just trying to make them a sale, we're also trying to keep them happy. And you don't even have to be a customer of ours to really benefit from this. So we find that a lot of people share this content, and it really is a great way of creating goodwill. If they're not a current customer, they may be a future customer of ours. So this kind of content really creates an emotional connection with customers, we find, and also allows us to kind of put ourselves out there as experts. So we do find that referrals really increase with this type of video. And I'm going to skip past that demonstration as well, since we're short on time. Let's go to the third type of video I wanted to mention, which is unexpected cultural video. This is the kind of video that you really don't necessarily expect from a blinds company. But we really feel like it reflects our culture of exploration, of experimenting, of trying new things. And so, for example, this particular young lady on the left-hand side here, if you ever watch MasterChef on Fox Network, she actually won last year's competition. Her name is Christine Ha. She's actually legally blind, but she was last season's winner, and she got quite a bit of fame as a result of that. Well, she happens to live near our office. We have a connection with her. And we asked if she wouldn't mind coming out and talking with our employees about her inspirational story. And we thought, well, since she's going to be coming by, maybe we can open that up and share it with others on the, you know, in the community or out there on the internet. So what we did was we did an experimental Google Hangouts on air live stream. And we took advantage of the opportunity to have Christine kind of just share her story, not just with our employees, but other folks out there. And it really, again, kind of created a lot of goodwill, allowed us to raise some money for charity. And it's something that really went so well, we're going to just continue this theme on a quarterly basis, which is just an inspirational type of theme. There's other kind of content that you can get out there. For example, on the top right here, it's actually an animated matchstick video that we had created for $5. by somebody in China that our person in PR actually just kind of ran across. And she just thought it was so cool, she just paid $5, and sure enough, we got a little 30-second video of our logo being made out of matchsticks. It's just kind of fun and creative. It doesn't really mean anything, but it's just different. And so in this case, we actually put this only on our Google Plus channel, because PR really feels like it's important sometimes just to share little bits of things with certain communities or certain groups to show that they're, you know, maybe a little different. You treat them a little different, a little special, give them little nuggets of content from time to time. And on the bottom right, that's just an example of an outsourced video we did with some of our blog affiliates and our blog affiliates, our ambassadors, our blogging ambassadors. And again, this is kind of a group of people that don't really work with our company. They're outside of our company. But we work with them to help promote our brand. And they actually sometimes will create DIY home decorating videos for us that don't relate to blinds necessarily. But it just gives us another little thing we can talk about in our social media. So really think about the fact that you don't have to necessarily create all of the content on your site. You can get other folks involved. You can get them to contribute and give you some great things that you can share out there in the world of video. So my challenge to you today is think creatively. So let's just finish up with a few points. One is just to know where your business is going. Try to align your videos with your business. If you're very culturally driven like we are, it's important to incorporate that into your videos. But whatever your business is, whenever it changes, be available to change with it. Just be consistent. Creativity trumps big budgets. So if you don't have a big budget, don't be concerned. I mean, we started off 16 square feet of space, and it worked out just fine. And you don't have to have the newest and latest equipment. Just, you know, have an idea, focus on it, execute on it, and just make your case over time as you build up your inventory, and you can show results. You know, you can go from basically nothing to a large-scale production. Third, culture does matter. Please incorporate your culture into your videos whenever you can. It really says who you are, and be consistent. And last, I would challenge you to experiment without fear, because there's so many things out there that you might learn just by experimentation. Whether or not you fail isn't really the main indicator. In fact, sometimes when you fail, you actually learn more than if you never tried at all. So that actually helps you be better, and it's actually fun at the same time. So I wanted to close with an idea of what I'm talking about with experimentation without fear. We recently moved from one office to a new office, and during this time, we actually did a little fun lip dub video to kind of document our transition. So I just took the last part of the video, and I thought I'd show that to you as a demonstration of how we at Blinds.com like to experiment without fear. Hopefully this video will play. Oh, there it is. Somebody say ho, ho, say ho, ho. Back it up, back it up, back it up, back it up, back it up. Yo, somebody say yeah, yeah. Say yeah, 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 yeah. Back it up, back it up, back it up, back it up, back it up. Back it up, 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 back it up. Give me room, give me room, give me room, come. That is our CEO, by the way, on the right. So, but thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Robert. There's actually job applications for Blinds.com in the back. And after that video, I think I'm looking for a new job. I know we're running really short on time, but let's open it up to some Q&A quick.
So with the explosion of curious if you guys have in your plans to incorporate some user-generated video into your video strategy.
Yes, we do, and we're going to use you.
One thing we need to be doing more at Blinds.com is to really get our customers to engage in their videos so that we can show a before and after maybe and how it makes a difference to our customers. So one of the things I'm going to work on when I get back is really getting more user-generated content that we can put with our products.
So is that, just as a follow-up question on user-generated content, is that a what kind of initiatives or ideas do you have to really kind of engage your customers and motivate them?
One really good way that comes to mind is through our social media. There's a lot of different ways we can encourage customers to contribute content that way and share that. And then I would also imagine, you know, if they're up for it, maybe as part of our purchasing process, it could be that if they, you know, if they want to deliver us some results from that, we can incentivize them in some way for future purchases.
That's good. Over here. Sorry, the pillar. So the question is on quality control?
For me, I personally wouldn't be too concerned because, I mean, obviously if it's not usable, you can't use it, but a lot of people don't really expect high-end professional video from customers. So I think anything that just basically doesn't make your product look bad is probably fine. You know, because people are just going to use their cell phone most likely. But as long as you can see the results, actually, I think a lot of people like that. They like to see authentic video and something that's not too highly polished or produced.
We've heard a lot in the last couple of days about videos that are really highly produced, videos that are just off the cell phone or less produced. All you guys are really more to me, you know, although the product videos are, there's some production technique and value in that. I mean, you could easily just take up a shoe with an iPhone. Why go the direction you went instead of just doing it off, or making it more, I don't know about authentic, but real, if you will, or gritty, you know, is there thoughts on that?
Do you guys have any?
I would love it if the site had more pictures or videos of actual customers wearing the shoes. I think that'd be even more effective. But I guess just, you know, trying to keep it simple. And it's crazy how even just shooting on like a white background and stuff requires like a certain level of technical.
And just I'm sorry.
No.
To follow up on that, for myself too, is it's nice to have a diversified range of content as well. Even shooting professional video, there's a reason, you know, B-roll footage is valuable. I think having user-generated content as well as professional content, I think all together, it really does just adds more value. It's diversified and it's more engaging for customers that not everything is the same. I mean, there's a reason not every movie was shot like Blair Witch Project. I mean, it's that diversification is important.
Yeah, I think a mix is really important. You try to find a balance or a blend. Don't go one way or the other way too much. I think a little bit of both is great.
Right. Yeah.
Question for Robert Reed. You mentioned that you've been working on selling through a new video studio. I think attribution is really important, especially with improving the value of video. Can you talk a little bit about how you've been able to kind of attribute that value of $13 a view?
Sure. Yeah, basically in LiveClicker, there's a very strong analytics package inside the back end. And, you know, we can basically see, based on the number of views relative to the amount of revenue that's being generated, an average amount of value per video viewed. And so these are just hard numbers, and it's very easy to put that out there. So as you're developing your budgets, as you're making your proposals, you can easily point to some of these numbers. And so that's really where the return comes back. You know, you may have to pay a little bit more sometimes for a certain platform that you work with, but if you can get those hard numbers, it's really going to help you sell your what you're doing as being valuable.
And I think in any case, shape, and form, you don't end up producing some videos and seeing a decrease in conversion. That's, you don't really see that very often. I've yet to really see it, so. I know, how are we doing, Jen? Okay.
Well, thank you, everyone.
Yeah, thank you, everybody.
We'll be around if you have any other questions.